we have some housekeeping here to start off with. Look, if you're going to take your final, you want to do a paper test, you can. I'll give you your study guide. I'll give you that next week, probably Wednesday. That's what I put on my calendar. The other part of that too is those who are electing to do a project, good on ya. I think it's one of those things where sometimes paper tests, you just study, 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 regurgitate, come back, and forget it all. With a project, you're gonna remember that stuff, and it's gonna benefit you in the long run. But either way, it's fine with me. I'm not pressuring you. I'm just biased toward one, not the other. We're gonna talk about President Woodrow Wilson. President Thomas Woodrow Wilson was born on December 28th, 1856. His father was a Presbyterian minister, and his father also was a Civil War chaplain, and their church was used as a medical tent or the medical facility during the Civil War. And he was a little boy helping out during that time. And you can just imagine why President Wilson became a pacifist. When you see the atrocities of war as a child, it's one of those things that you're not going to want to be a part of that as an adult, and you know how that's going to work. After he graduated high school, he attended Princeton University and went to the, got his bachelor's degree there, decided he was going to be a lawyer, went over to the University of Virginia School of Law. That wasn't his thing, and headed over to Johns Hopkins University to get his PhD in government and politics, and he's the only president to have a PhD. He wrote a whole bunch of books, and some of the books that he read were Wilson's, Congressional Government, A Study of in American Politics. He did the State Elements of Historical Politics in Practice. Elements of Historical and Political Politics, and A History of the United States, Division and Reunion. Interesting. I was looking at that whole biography piece, and I was thinking that's something that I would be interested in taking a look at. And the last one was Constitutional Government in the United States. But there's a whole bunch of books in between. I can just go down the list. I don't really think that's a good idea. I have a lot to cover tonight. So we're going to move on to the next piece. There's going to be a question that follows this piece right here.
Lord, I've really been real stressed, down and out, losing grass. Although I am black and grass, problems got me pessimistic. Brothers and sisters keep messing up. Why does it have to be so damn tough? I don't know where I can go to let these ghosts out of my skull. My grandma passed, my brother's gone. I never at once felt so alone. I know you're supposed to be my steering wheel, not just my spare tire. My God, force the truth. For some strange reason, it had to be. He guided me to Tennessee. Take me to another place. Take me to another
land. In 1885, Wilson married Ellen Louise Axon, the daughter of a Presbyterian minister from Rome, Georgia, with whom he had three daughters. It was a happy marriage, warm. Everything was good, but it was shadowed by Ellen's bouts with depression, and then of course Wilson's extramarital affair with another lady, Mary Ellen Peck. She died in 1914, and it devastated him with grief as it would any man, and he ended up getting through that grief not much longer and married a lady named Edith Galt in 1915. Wilson was a professional academic before he became president. He began his career teaching history and political science at Bryn Mawr College in 1885 and moved to Wesleyan University shortly after that, a couple years after that in 1888. 2 years after that, he ended up going to Princeton, quickly rose up through the ranks, becomes a president, starts to turn the school around with lots of reform. The biography says far-reaching reforms, but today we would call those radical reforms. But it was only met by opposition from the conservative faculty and also from alumni and donors. And that wasn't going to be a thing they were going to deal with. They didn't want somebody in the school that was going to make such radical changes for student democracies and all this kind of stuff, he had to abandon it.
Now my life got flipped, turned upside down, and I'd like to take a minute, just sit right there. I'll tell you how I became the prince of a town called Bel Air.
Meanwhile, Wilson became very popular being at Princeton and attracted the attention of the conservative kingmakers in the Democratic Party, who offered him the 1910 nomination for governor of New Jersey. After that, he resigned his position at Princeton, decided that he was going to run for governor, won the election, made a bunch of reforms in New Jersey, gained him such popularity that he gained the political or the Democratic presidential nomination for the 1912 elections. After a hard struggle with President Roosevelt and his Blue Moose Convention, the split now super conservative Republican Party, and we read about that. He won 42% of the popular vote, and it was a landslide with the electoral votes against Taft and Roosevelt. Roosevelt ran on new nationalism. President Wilson ran on the new freedom. During Wilson's first presidency, gave him a supreme chance to put his ideas about government to work, admitting that he intended to conduct himself as a prime minister. He drew up a legislative program in advance, broke with previous presidential practices by appearing before Congress in person, and worked mainly through his party. Wilson, he kept Congress in session continually from April 13th to October of 1914. From April 1913 to October of 1914, almost a year and a half, something that had never been done before, not even during the Civil War. And Wilson's approach achieved pretty good results. He was able to create the federal, the FTC to oversee business, Federal Trade Commission, established the Federal Reserve, which is now the most powerful government agency in our government system. Wilson was doing great. He was changing the country, reforms, passing all kinds of legislation, but his biggest weakness was him turning a blind eye to segregation. He was already from the South, and people were already calling him on that, considered him a racist. And people started rioting in the streets because there was nobody to help him. NAACP started to do some pretty crazy things as well. And they were, of course, trying to push the government, trying to get into the government, but it wasn't working. And the biggest thing was white and colored restrooms. That drove people crazy. And that's not what they wanted. Not everybody wanted segregation. It was just something pushed, as we talked about during Reconstruction, that just kept going. And there was really no ifs, ands, or buts, like how we're going to approach it. And the only thing Wilson did was he made a move toward improving race relations in July of 1918. During his second term, when he eloquently but belatedly condemned lynching. Please answer the question following this segment. Come 1916, during the presidential election, President Wilson wins a second election. The campaign cry was, he kept us out of war. It helped, but Wilson's domestic record on progressive and labor issues played the biggest part in his achieving a healthy plurality in the popular vote and a small electoral margin. So you can see there's some things changing right there. And here's the other thing too, is Congress flipped as well. So there was a loss of seats in the Democrats, and there was more Republican surge right after that time. The start of also during this election, the World War I started in 1914, which this is why we're alluding to that. The thing about that is people Some people wanted to go help Great Britain, others didn't. Wilson, he was a pacifist, did everything in his power to keep out of war with the Germans. And he tried making peace after he was elected through creating a League of Nations. I always consider that, like, he tried to create the Lakers back then, an all-star team, but it didn't work out. Eventually it would, but not this time. And the he made his first diplomatic appeal in January in 1917 to see where Congress was, where the Senate was, and he gave this like rousing speech, and he called for peace without victory, and pledged to establish the League of Nations to prevent future wars. The great idea, and eventually we have that now. It was his idea, but it was taking a little too long for him to do that. There was one thing, it was called the Zimmerman Telegram. That it was a controversial subject. I wanted to read that, actually verbatim. Zimmerman Telegram, it was a secret communication by the German Foreign Secretary that offered Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona to Mexico in return for going to war against the United States. So they were saying, hey Mexico, you wanna go to war? We'll give you Texas, Arizona, and New Mexico. Wilson, that really caused a lot of issues. He decided to intervene, mainly because he could see no alternative and hoped to use American belligerency as a means to build a just, lasting peace. And then, of course, a couple other things that, he tried to make peace. And then on May 17th, a U-boat sank the British liner Lusitania, killing more than 1,100 people, including 128 Americans. And that's when the war came home with a vengeance. Wilson urges countrymen to show restraint, declaring there is no such thing as a man being too proud to fight. But he also pressed the Germans to rein in their submarines and decided to build up that's when he started to decide to build up his armed forces and get everything ready. And there's Selective Service Act was put in place so we can build our military through a draft system. And that is where I'm gonna leave it. We're starting World War I next week. I'm gonna post a couple videos before the final. If you decide that you wanna take the paper test, let me know. If you wanna do your project, let me know. Either way, I'm good. I appreciate all the hard work you all are putting in. I had to turn my email off. You guys are blowing it up, but that's good. And I hope I've been in quick communication with you all. Sometimes I do have to go downstairs and pump a little iron, go on walks, get some air, but I'm trying to stay up with each of you to make sure that I'm answering your questions. And finally, don't be stagnant. Get up in the mornings. I know some of you take your brothers and sisters to school, and I know your parents aren't gonna let you out of that, so don't go home and go to sleep. Go home, maybe go exercise, go do something that's gonna be good to get your blood flowing, get good rest. We don't wanna come back from the break lethargic, myself included. So I'm following my own advice, and drink lots of water, stay healthy.